गुड मॉर्निंग सी ओनली अबाउट हाफ ऑफ द क्लास क्या गुड मॉर्निंग जगदीश हाउ आर यू फाइन थिंग्स आर फाइन इन इंस्टीट्यूट एक्सेप्ट दैट वी डोंट हैव द स्टूडेंट्स हियर ओके दैट्स समथिंग वी आर मिसिंग अ लॉट वी मेट वेट फॉर सम मोर टाइम मे बी अनदर couple of months before students can come back, I guess. Yeah, I know. But missing all the fun that you normally have with your friends. Right? Yeah. Yeah, we have to be patient. We have to wait for things to become normal, right? Because there is absolutely no way we can handle if there is an infection of this corona amongst the students. Okay. It's extremely difficult to control that spread. Yeah. Yeah, that's where you people sit then work together and have a lot of fun, right? The DCF labs. Even this lab course, normally we do it in the lab here, right? During the lab hours, we ask the students to come and sit there and then do all the coding, even if it's HTL assignments, right? We ask the students to do the assignments during the lab hours. And try to complete it during a lab session to the extent possible. And those who cannot complete, no, they can take a little bit more time outside the class and then complete and submit. And it's also easy to clarify the doubts to the students when they are in the lab here. Yeah, all of that fun is missing now. Okay, I think let's get started. See that the count is only 68. Maybe the other people will join quickly. Okay, any questions about this CLA based adders? So what we have looked at the last class was how to design the carry look ahead based adder. So basically we try to generate the carry terms as soon as possible, because the generation of some bits is dependent on the carry bits. So in the simplest CLA based adder, right, we have the expressions for generation of each of the carries, all right, and after they're generated, we generate the sum bits. We can reduce the time significantly compared to the ripple carry adder, right? But still, that's not good enough, right? So that's where, at the end of last class, we are looking at what is called the using higher level propagate and generate terms. Okay. So I just want you to make sure that you understand the one level propagate and generate terms, where typically we generate this propagate terms like P0, P1, P2, P3, and then generate terms G0, G1, G2, and G3, right? And once they are available, right, then we can generate the carry bits, right, using this P terms, right? And once C4 is available, that will be made available, and that's given as input to the next four level, four bit CLA block, right? And then we generate C5, C6, C7, C8, and so on, right? And we have done the timing analysis for this, okay? Yeah. And at the end of last class, we are looking at how to generate what are called the higher order propagate and generate terms, or higher level propagate and generate terms. So now, if you look at the expression for CO, we have all these PI terms and the GI terms, right? And the first term here without C naught, now we'll call it as the P0 level 1. And the rest of the term here, that is the other than the first term here, the rest of the terms in the expression for C4, we'll call it as the G0 at the level 1. Okay. So now we can see that I can express C4 in terms of this P01 C0 plus G01. In a similar way, we can express C8 also in terms of these higher order propagate and generate terms. What will be P1i? I'll just write for one more. What will be P1i? So P1i is associated with the second group of 4 bits. So that will have P7, P6, P5, P4, then C4, right? Then P7, P6, P5. G4, right? And P7, P6, G5, plus P7, G6, plus G7, right? Now, sorry, this is expression for C8, right? And now we'll call this as P1i, and whole of for this, excluding this, right, as the G1i. So now we can see that C8 is expressed as P1 level 1, C4 plus G1 level 1. And similarly, we can come up with expressions for C12 and C16. Okay, so now let's see how much time it will take to generate the output of a 16-bit adder using this higher level terms. So we have the operands at time t equal to 0. So we're talking about n equal to 16. Okay, and we can generate all the PIs and GIs. Right, I equal to 0 to F15 after 1 tau, because each of these PIs and GIs are expressed in terms of the corresponding operand bits XI and YI. Right? Yeah. Now tell me how much time it will take to generate the higher order terms. So at what time, let's say, right, this as PK1, right? So in this case, we need P01, P11, P21, and P31. What is the expression for P01? It is an AND operation on P3, P2, P1, and P0, all right? So it requires one AND gate. And similarly, any of these PK items can be generated from the P terms, right, by passing them through an AND gate. So this will be available at 2 tau. Okay. What about the GKIs? So we can see that the expression for GKIs, right, is a two-level logic gate expression, right? That is a sum of the products term, right? And after PAs and GAs are available, right, it will take 2 tau, right? So this will be available at 3 tau. Okay? Yeah. Now, once this PK1s and GK1s are available, we can generate all the carries C4, C8, and C12 and C16, right? Using this expression for them in terms of the PKIs and PK1s and the GK1s, right? And after GKs are available, it will take 2 tau, right, to generate this C4, C8, and C12. So that will be 5 tau. And once this C4, C8, C12 are available, then we can generate all the internal carries, that is C0, sorry, C1, C2, C3. They are the other internal carries for the first four level, the first four bit CLA, right? Then C5, C6, C7, right? Then C9, C10, C11, then C13, C14, and C15. So C1, C2, C3 will generate using C0, C5, C6, C7 will generate using C4, C9, C10, C11 will generate using C8, and so on. And what is the expression for each of them? Right? They'll be similar to a two level logic gate expression that we have seen, right? Like this. So we have the expression for C1, C2, C3, right? Similar expressions will be there for C5, C6, and C7 in terms of P terms and the C4. P terms, G terms, and the C4, right? So it's basically a two-level logic gate expression that's required to generate these internal carries, right? After the C4, C8, C12, C16 are available, right? So all of these are going to be available at 7 tau. And once all the carry bits are available, right, then we can generate the sum bits. Right, at 8 tau. Right, so basically, we see that when you use these higher level propagate and generate terms, the time the circuit takes to generate the sum bits is going to be 8 tau. So, now let's compare it with the two circuits that we have seen earlier. If it's a ripple carry adder for n equals 16, it will be 32 tau. Right. And if I'm using only first level of CLA, right? That is, I don't use the higher level terms. If I use only PIs and GIs, what is the time taken? As we have seen, it's n by 2 plus 2 when n is a multiple of 4, right? It takes, 16 by 2 plus 2, that is 10 tau. And when I use the higher level terms, right, then it comes down to 8 tau. Maybe find that it's not very significant, right? It is reducing only from 10 tau to 8 tau. Obviously, we are going to see that, right? This reduction in the time is not significant for n equals 16, right? Now, we'll make use of this 16-bit adder, which is built in this manner as a module to build the adders for larger values of n. So now let's say I use these 16-bit modules to build 64-bit adder. So we'll use four 16-bit adders that use 3 propagate and generate. Right? What are we saying? So we'll have one 16-bit adder which will take C0 as input, right? And the first 16 bits, right?
x0 to x15, y0 to y15, then it should generate the sum bits 15 and it will generate the C16. Right? And if I'm going to build the 16 bit adder using the higher level profligate terms, what time are these entities available? Yeah. We have seen that C16 is available at 5 tau. Right? And all the sum bits will be available by 8 tau. Okay? Now let's see when we put number of such 16-bit adders together. So each of these 16-bit adders will take the corresponding arguments or operands, right? So this will take 16 to 31, sorry. Yeah, you can write down. Should be 248. Yeah. Okay. So the inputs for each of them are 16-bit entities. So you can mark that. Okay, yeah. Now I want you to take a minute to tell me at what time the outputs of each of these 16-bit adders is going to be available. Yeah, unless you understand the flow completely, right? It's not easy to come up with the answer here. So to understand internal operations of this 16-bit adder. Okay. So let's take the second 16-bit adder. The input to this C16 is available at 5 tau. Of course, the operand bits are available much earlier, right? So after C16 is available, how much time it will take to generate C32. Yeah. So what is it we see here? Yeah. What's it involved in generating C32? Actually, C32 will be generated along with C20, C24, and C28. Right, and we'll express each of these C20, C24, C28, and C32 in terms of this higher order propagate and generate terms. Right, and all the higher order propagate and generate terms are available by 3 tau. Right, so they are waiting for only C16, and once C16 is available, we have a two-level logic gate expression, right, in terms of the higher order propagate terms and the generate terms and the input carry C16. So
it will take two more tau to generate the carry bits C20, 24 and 28 along with the 32. Right? So you can easily verify that it will take 7 tau to generate C32 and C20, C24 and C28. And once they are available, the internal carries to this 16-bit adder will be generated by going through another two-level logic gate circuit, right? And so they will be available at 9 tau, right? And then these internal carries will be used to generate the sum bits, right? So this will be available at 10 tau, right? So basically, we need to understand the flow of the data here. And the C16 is available at 5 tau, right? And once they are available, then we generate this C20, 24, 28, and 32 at 7 tau. Then all the other carries like C17, 18, 19, and so on will be available at 9 tau. And once those carries are available, it will take one more logic gate delay to generate the sum bits. So that will be available at 10 tau, right? And we can extend the same logic here now, right? To note that the C48 will be available at 9 tau, and this will be available at 12 tau, right? And this will be available at 11 tau, and this will be available at 14 tau, right? So now let's compare this. So what did we have here? N equal to 64. If it's a ripple carry adder, it will take 128 tau. If I'm using only typical 4-bit CLS without a higher order terms, right? It is n by 2 plus 2, right? So it will take 34 tau, right? So if I use 4-bit CLS and higher level terms, right? You see that it takes 14 tau, okay? So now we see that from 34 tau, it comes down to 14 tau, which is a significant reduction in the time taken. And I leave it as an exercise for you to figure that the n-bit adder, which is built in this manner, right, will have a delay of 2 n by 16 ceiling plus 6, right? You can come up with that expression. How that 6 comes, you need to figure that out, right? It all depends on when the different propagate terms are available, when the internal carries are available, and when the sum bits are generated. So that's what that 6 will take care of, right? And this 2 multiplied by n by 16 is coming because the output carry from each of the 16 bits address is available after 2 tau, after the input carry is available, right? And the number of such 16-bit adders required is the n by 16, right? So that's where that first term comes in, right? And the total delay is 14 tau, right? And if you go for 128 tau, we can see that, if n equal to 128, right, then we can see that the reduction is going to be even more significant. Again, we'll be seeing the need for adding 128-bit entities later, or maybe not 128, maybe somewhere greater than 64 and less than 128. We'll be seeing that we'll be using them in the floating point adder slate or floating point circuit slate. Okay, yeah. Any questions about this? Yeah, all sum bits are available at 14 tau. Correct, Vikram. Yeah, I think that's what we derived it as. Yeah.
Okay, if there are no other questions, let's just continue. Okay, I'll just ask you whether this generation of the higher level propagated and generated terms can be extended further to even more levels. That is, we talked about PK level ones, right? Can we talk about something like PJ level two? Okay, I'll just leave it as an exercise for those who are interested, right? If you are really interested in, please refer to the Hemashire's book, right? Where it talks about even second level terms, that is P0 level 2, P1 level 2, and so on, right? And that can be used further to reduce the time, but we have to pay price in terms of the additional logic circuitry that's required, okay? So I leave it as an exercise for those who are interested to look into it, right? And then see the details in the book on computer organization by Hemashire. Okay, now that we understood how to design an n-bit adder, right? And we have not made any assumptions whether these input operands are unsigned integers or the signed integers, right? If it is only addition operation is required, right, then it doesn't matter, right? We can use this n-bit adder, right, to add n-bit operands of either unsigned integer type or the signed integer type. Only thing is, the overflow detection will be different in the two cases. How do we detect the overflow in the unsigned integers? Suppose I take two 4-bit values, right? Let's say x equal to 6 and y is equal to 11, right? You can verify that 6 is 0, 1, 1, 0, and y is 11, that is 1, 0, 1, 1, right? And when we add them bit by bit, right? Actually, this corresponds to 17, but if my z is also declared as a 4-bit variable, right, then this what will be assigned to z, which is not really correct because it says the value of z is 1, right? But what is happening here is there is an overflow because the value of 17 that we are supposed to get by adding this x and y exceeds the range of values the 4-bit unsigned representations can have, because we've seen that for unsigned integers, the range of values is 0 to 2 power n minus 1, that is, right? So in this case, it is 0 to 15. So whenever the sum of the two operands exceeds the maximum possible value that can be represented, then it results in a overflow. How do we detect this overflow when we perform the addition? We can see that whenever there is overflow, there will be a carry out of the most significant bit here. So in this case, it will be bit C4, that is the carry at the bit position 4. And in general, we can see that if Cn equal to 1, right, then that indicates a overflow condition. So whenever we are performing the addition operation on the unsigned integers, Cn equal to 1 indicates that it is a overflow condition. Okay. And in the case of the signed integers, which are represented in the 2's complement form, we have seen earlier, we have seen some examples, right? Whenever Cn is not equal to Cn minus 1, that is, now in the case of the signed integers, the xn minus 1 and yn minus 1 are signed bits. Right, and if there is a carry into the signed bit and there is a carry out of the signed bit, right, then there is no overflow. Or if there is no carry into the signed bit and there is no carry out of the signed bit, right, then there is no overflow. Only if it is other case, right, that is, there is a carry into the signed bit but there is no carry out of the signed bit, that is one case. Or there is a no carry into the signed bit but there is a carry out of the signed bit, right, then that results in the overflow condition. Basically, we are dealing with two numbers of same sign, right? And the magnitude of the numbers that we are adding exceeds the range of the values that can be represented In the case of the signed integers, we have seen that the range of values is minus 2 power n minus 1 to 2 power n minus 1 minus 1, right? So whenever we are adding two operands of the same sign, if it's positive, right, then there can be overflow because the sum value is exceeding 2 power n minus 1 minus 1, right? And whenever you are adding two negative numbers, if the resultant sum is less than minus 2 power n minus 1, that also results in a overflow condition, right? So there'll be circuits, right? Either looking at Cn or looking at whether Cn and Cn and Cn minus 1 are same or not, right? And basically, you need to use a exclusive OR gate, right, to determine if there is an overflow condition, right? So basically, overflow in this case will be, if I have a bit called overflow bit, right? So we can see that I can simply perform an exclusive OR operation on the Cn and Cn minus 1, right? That will set the overflow bit to 1, right? Whenever these two carries are different, right? And if the carries have to be same bits, right, then there is no overflow. So that is the only difference that you need to have, right, when you are using an n-bit adder for the unsigned integers or the signed integers. Okay. Now, we can use a single n-bit adder to design a circuit that can perform addition as well as subtraction by making a few modifications to the circuit. Suppose I designed an n-bit adder using any of the methods that we have seen earlier. Let's first look at the for the signed integers. We'll come back to the unsigned integers quickly. So I have x here, right? And I'll have y here. So normally we'll have a C0 bit. And this will generate S bits, right? Where S bit should correspond to either X plus Y or X minus Y. Right? So now I want to use only one n-bit adder, right, to perform either addition operation or the subtraction operation on the two operands X and Y. Okay. So now let's say we have a control signal. Actually, we'll be introducing now what are called the control signals that specify which operation has to be carried out. And in this case, we call this control signal as we'll use this kind of a notation as we go along. It's A bar stroke S, right? As we've seen quickly, whenever I want to perform an addition operation on X and Y, then we'll set this bit to 0. This is a single bit, right? So we'll set this single bit to 0. And whenever I want to perform the subtraction operation of y from x, right, then we'll set this bit to 1, right? So if I want to perform the addition operation, what is it I have to do? I have to just pass this y as t is to the n-bit adder and then make c not equal to 0, right? Then the n-bit adder will give me the sum, where S will correspond to X plus Y, right? So when I want to perform the addition operation, what is it I need to do? I have to make the C naught input to 0, right? And I just have to pass Y as T to the n-bit adder to this as the second operand. Then the n-bit adder will produce the sum for that. What about if I have to perform subtraction? That is, if I want to do X minus Y, right? That's what I want S to be. We've seen that you can do this by X plus minus Y. Then how do I generate minus Y? I have to perform a 2's complement operation on Y. What is the 2's complement operation on Y? We have to add one in the least significant position after we perform the 1's complement operation on the Y. What is the 1's complement operation on Y? It's toggling the bits. How do I toggle the bits using the logic gates? We've seen that the toggling operation can be done by using an exclusive OR gate with the other input being 1. That is, we've seen that if I have a variable let's say W, right? If I want to generate W complement, right? W exclusive or 1 will give us W complement, right? And if I don't want to toggle, right, then I have to just give the input as 0 to the exclusive OR gate, right? So we make use of this property that the complements of the bits can be generated by using the exclusive OR gate with the second input as 1. And whenever we don't want to toggle, right, we can use the second input as 0. So basically what we are saying is that now we'll use this control signal A bar S as input to the circuit, sorry. Okay. So X will be passed on as it is. Now we'll have an XOR block here. Okay. Where one input to the XOR block is Y operand, the other one is okay. What does this block mean here? Y XOR A bar S, right? So Y is a n bit entity, Y n minus 1, Y n minus 2, so on. Y1 and Y0, right? Now this A bar S will take either 0 or 1. If it's 0, then we want to perform the addition operation. Otherwise, we want to perform the subtraction operation. Whenever it's a subtraction operation, we need to generate the complements of these bits, right? So basically, what you are saying is that we toggle these bits, right, to get Y0, Y1, so on. Right, so basically there'll be Y naught exclusive OR this bit, A bar S, Y1 exclusive OR A bar S, and so on. Right, so each of the bits of the Y operand will be exclusive OR operated with the control bit A bar S. Right, if A bar is 0, then it will generate Y itself. If A bar S is 1, right, then we'll get the ones complement of the Y. And to that ones complement of the Y, we are adding 1 in the least significant bit position, because this will act as the C0. C0 is added in the least significant bit position. So basically, we are generating the minus Y by using this exclusive OR gate whenever this A bar S bit is 1. And the output now S will correspond to X minus Y, right? So S will be X minus Y if A bar S equal to 0, right? And if A bar S equal to 1, the output of this n bit adder will correspond to X minus Y. So basically, we don't have to use two different circuits to perform the addition and subtraction operation. By making use of the two's complement representation properties, right, we can use the single n-bit adder, right, to perform either the addition operation or the subtraction operation, right? And this is what is typically done. And we can generate the overflow bits, right, by using the CN and the CN minus 1, as we have seen earlier. Okay, yeah, any questions about that? What is the delay of this circuit now? There'll be an additional delay of 1 tau because all the Y bits have to go through one exclusive OR gate for each of the bits, right? But they'll be in parallel, right? So that will have 1 tau delay, right? But other than that, the delay of the n-bit adder is the one that will predominate, right, for the addition subtraction operations. Okay, so this is actually for the signed integers, and I'm going to just leave it as the exercise for you to verify that. I can also use this circuit for subtraction operation on the unsigned integers with the condition that Y should be less than X, because when you are performing the subtraction on the unsigned integers, if the result also has to be assigned to a variable of the unsigned integer type, right, then it is necessary that the second operand is of a smaller magnitude than the first operand, right? If that property is met, right, I can use the same circuit as what we have given here, right, to perform the subtraction operation, okay, and then generate the output which will correspond to x minus y with the condition that y is less than x being guaranteed, okay. And typically when you write the programs for unsigned integer variables, it is your responsibility to make sure that y is smaller than x before you perform x minus y and then assign the result to another variable of the same unsigned integer type, okay. Then the circuit can be used. I will leave it as an exercise for you to verify that, right? what I am saying will hold good, okay. You can take two unsigned integer values, right, and then try to subtract them using this circuit, right, and then verify what is it you will get, okay. Yeah, any questions? We have to increment as well, right? Where is the increment operation required? Because we are making that a bar is bit as 1, that will go as C0, right? That's effectively adding 1 in the least increment bit position. That's what I'm saying. After the XOR block, right, we don't have to add 1 explicitly, because if you look at the input here, which I will mark it as C0, right? What is C0 when the subtraction operation is carried out? This bit will be equal to 1, right? So basically, we are giving the C0 equal to 1. Where is that C0 getting added? It will go to the full adder circuit in the bit 0 position, right? That is equal to adding 1, right, to the output of this exclusive OR block, right? So that's what is being done to take care of that increment operation. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Good. But I want you to make sure that you are comfortable with all these analysis that we are doing, right? Because quickly we'll be looking at a little bit more involved circuits, right? And unless you have understood how this timing analysis is done, right, doing the timing analysis for more involved circuits is going to be a little complex, right, and it's very important that you understand this timing analysis process. Okay. Now let's see the next circuit that you want to design, which is the multiplication circuits. Okay, and first we'll discuss for unsigned integers, and as we'll be seeing later, it will be required to design one circuit for multiplication of unsigned integers and another circuit for multiplication of the signed integers. And if you look at the instruction set of any processor, there will be two different multiplication instructions: one multiplication instruction for the unsigned integers and another multiplication instruction for the signed integers, because the way the input operand bits have to be processed is completely different for the unsigned integer multiplication compared to that for the signed integer multiplication. We'll come back to that as we go along. Okay, so now our target is to perform a multiplication operation on two operands, x and y, right, and then generate the product and then assign it to variable z. Okay, and right now we are assuming that all these operands x, y, and z are all going to be unsigned integers. Okay, so how do you perform this integer multiplication operation? What do you think can be the method that can be used for the multiplication of the numbers? How to perform the multiplication of decimal numbers? Okay, let's take a simple case. Yeah. So if I am required to multiply these 2 3-bit numbers in a decimal system, right? How do we do this multiplication by hand? we have what is called the multiplier operand, right? And we have the multiplicand operand, right? How do you do this multiplication? We take the first digit here, that is the least significant digit in the ones position, right? And then multiply the multiplicand operand with the first digit in the multiplier operand, right? So in this case, let's say we get 428, right? So let's say I call this as x and this is y, and we refer to each of these digits here as y2, y1 and y0. Please remember that we are now dealing with the decimal numbers, right? So what are we doing now here? We are taking the multiplicand operand x and then multiplying it with the first digit y0 of the multiplier operand, right? And then getting the product of that. Actually, this is what is referred to as the partial product, right? So we'll shortly call it as the partial product, which is PP. And because we are getting this partial product by using the digit in the zeroth position, right, we'll refer to it as the PPG. Yeah, after we get this first partial product, what is it we do? We take the multiplicand operand and then take the second digit in the multiplier operand, then we multiply it. And where do we put the result of that? We don't put it before this partial product. We shift that, right, by one digit position, right, and then position that, right? So in this case, it is 642, right? So we're not putting 642 exactly below 428. We are shifting this product of 214 multiplied by 3 to the left by one digit position and then doing that. Because what is the weight of this position here? The weight of this position is 10. So basically what we are doing is effectively multiplying this x with y1, right? And then multiplying by 10, right? So what is this partial product 0 here? It is x multiplied by y0. What is the second partial product? It is x multiplied by y1 multiplied by 10 power 1. Actually, here it is 10 power 0, right? So by shifting this product of x with the y1 by one digit position to the left, we are effectively multiplying it by. And we continue this process till we come to the most significant digit in the multiplier operand. In this case, it is 1, right? And we'll put the partial product of that, right? So this is partial product 2. This is x multiplied by y2 to 10 power 2. Then once we get all these partial products, right, then we perform the sum. I mean, we are doing it manually now. To get the product, right? What will be the number of digits in the product here? Maximum it can go to 6 digits when we are multiplying two three digit numbers, right? So the number of digits required to hold the product is double the number of digits in each of the operands, right? But normally, what do we do when we write a program? We declare both x, y, and z as the variables of same type. That is, let's say, if I want all of them to be 16-bit unsigned integers, right? We declare x, y, and z as the unsigned short int. And then if we perform the product of x and y, the multiplication of x and y, then we want to assign it to z, right? What is it assumed? We'll assume that the product of x and y will also fit into the range of 16-bit unsigned integers, and that's what will be assigned to z. And what has to be done if the product does not fit into the 16-bit values, right? So that should be detected as the overflow, right? So when we design the circuit, we are going to see how to generate the partial products similar to what we are doing with the decimal number system, right? And then how do you check for the overflow condition where the product of the two operands does not fit into the range of values that can be represented by the n bits we are assigning for the operands, Okay, actually this is the method that we normally use for multiplication by hand, right? And this method is also referred to as the paper pencil method, because typically if you want to perform the multiplication, we use the paper and pencil, right? Of course, nowadays we use the calculator. That's a different issue, right? But if you are forced to do the multiplication by hand, right? Typically, you have to use a paper and pencil, right? So that's why this method is referred to as the paper and pencil method. Now, if I want to do the same thing on the binary system, right? Where let's say I'm talking about n equal to 4, right? My x is y3, y2, y1, and y0. This way. Right? Now I want to perform product of this x and y, and then generate the z, and z also will be so we'll assume that the product will fit into 4-bit values, right? And whenever it does not, right, then we have to detect that condition. Right, so can we use the same paper and pencil method to perform the bit by bit multiplication and multiplication of numbers in the binary system? Right, so let's take a simple example. Right, so okay, I'm taking the case where the product will not fit into the 4-bit value, right? But let's go through the operation, right? So I have two 4-bit values here, right? This is x and this is y, right? And x is obviously 10 and y equal to 6, right? The product will be 60, right? So obviously it will not fit. Okay, we'll come back to it later. Okay, so suppose I want to perform the multiplication of these, right? How do we do this? So we take x and then take the first bit y0 here, then multiply. What is the multiplication we're talking about? It's a an AND operation. It's a logical product operation. So it will be 0, 0, 0, 0, right? So this is actually the partial product 0, because it is x ANDed with y0, then it's 2 power 0. Once we generate the first partial product, then we take the second bit of the y, which happens to be 1 here, right? And then perform the product operation with the x, right? So that will be 1, 0, 1, 0, right? And then we are shifting this product by 1 bit to the left, which is effectively shifting, which is effectively multiplying by 2. This is what we discussed earlier, right? We can perform the multiplication by a power of 2 by shifting the bit sequence to the left by the corresponding number of bits, right? Now we continue this process. And then we need to perform the addition of these products. So this is BP2. And you can just simply add here manually. So let's say I put 0 here. You can verify that the value of this you can verify that it's actually will come to 16, because we have 4 here, then 8 here, 16 here, and 32, right? So 32 plus 16 is 48, plus 8, 56, plus 4 is 60, right? So in this case, 8 bits are required to represent the product. Okay, we'll come back to it later. But I want you to understand the process here. What you're doing here is similar to what you do in the decimal number system. We take the x operand, which is the multiplicand operand, then we take every bit of multiplier operand, and then we perform the multiplication of this x with the each bit of the y, and then we generate the partial products. And we also do this multiplication by power of 2, right? Effectively by spatially positioning this product, right? And that will generate the corresponding partial products. And then we add all these partial products. Okay, I'll just quickly close now. The circuit that we need to build is required to generate all these partial products, then put them in the proper positions, right? And then add these partial products in order to generate the final product. Okay, so I just want to give you a clue that all these operations can be done using logic gates, which are simply AND gates, and the full adder circuits, one bit full adder circuits. Okay, and we'll simply map these operations onto a logic circuit, right, which can perform the multiplication operation, and that will be called as the combinational array multiplier. And tomorrow we'll see the circuit diagram for that, and then we'll try to analyze the time taken to perform the operations for that circuit. Okay, maybe I'll stop at this point. If there are any questions, let's take that. Yeah. Any questions about the multiplier circuit that we are talking about? I mean, operations in the design of the multiplier circuit. Okay. I think it looks like there are no questions. Okay. If there are no questions, maybe we'll stop here. Right, we'll meet at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
Sir,
yeah.
Can you tell in brief about the evaluation process for CH2300 course?
Okay. What has been suggested to for all the core courses is 20% for internals and 80% for the end exam. Okay, this is a guideline given by the Dean Academic Courses. Okay. I think we are going to follow that. So we will have some tutorials for this CS2300 course. All the tutorials will put together carry 20 marks, and the remaining 80 marks will be for the end sum exam. Okay.
Yeah. Like as you know that the end sums are not surely to be taken. So can we in case just increase the percentage of dependence on things not other than NSEM?
No, NSEM exams will be conducted whenever it's possible to conduct. Okay, that may happen maybe sometime in December or January, right, when the people are likely to move around. I mean, there are plans to conduct the NSEM examinations either at IIT itself or at these examination centers of companies like TCS, where all these JEE and other exams are conducted, right? So one plan is the students can go there to the nearby centers of these companies, right? And then it will be a proper written exam. We'll send the question paper there and the answer scripts will be given to you, answer sheets will be given to you. Then you have to write on the answer sheets. Then the answer sheets will be scanned and then sent to the faculty here. Okay, then that will be evaluated, right? So these are all the plans that are being considered. Okay, but we'll take the final call depending on the situation in regard to this corona. Okay, and assuming that these written exams will be conducted whenever it's possible, right, we want to keep the weightage for that final exam to 80%.
Actually, like it would be hard to conduct the exams just after the course gets finished. Like there would be some 1 or 2 months gap between the exam and the course.
It so, is possible. I cannot rule that out. Right? Yeah. But what can be done?
So, in that case, can we reduce the percentage of dependence on NSEM? Like, have less credit for NSEM and more for
the problem internal. Is, if you have to give more weightage for what are called these tutorials, no. The question is, how do we have these tutorials, no? Proctored or invigilated, and how do we ensure that there's no copying? Okay, that's where the problem lies. I know that AMI is trying out for the data structures course, right? But that requires a massive effort for every tutorial. Okay, yeah, we were told about that recently, right? But what I'm thinking of is a little simpler one, right? We'll have a tutorial session basically. We'll give you a problem sheet for you to work out, and then we'll give you some fixed amount of time. then you need to solve the problems and submit solutions by taking the photocopy or the scan copy of the sheets on which you write, and then submit them by uploading them into our module or that grade scope. Okay, so that's one alternate we are thinking of. And unfortunately, we cannot rule out people, students interacting with one another and then kind of possibly copying. Okay, and if that is the case, we don't want to give too much of weightage for this internal assessment. Yeah, actually, there are not going to be any assignments, because in this course, it's not possible to give any programming assignments for the theory course, right? It has to be problem solving exercises in the form of the tutorials. Okay. So I'll take a little bit more time to decide on the modalities for conducting these online tutorials, right? And we may have one online tutorial in about a week or 2 weeks. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Any other questions? Okay. If there are no other questions, maybe we'll stop here.